in your life and all that.
Sometimes it takes a lot of time with you. It seems to be starting again. They did something wrong, but for 2 minutes.
Thank you.
holy communion, and thank you all for coming to this service. Today is the sixth Sunday in Easter, the sixth Sunday of Easter, and we also give thanks for the mothers we have. And today we also celebrate Mother's Day. May I take this opportunity to say happy Mother's Day to all mothers. May God bless you and thank you for continuing to care for us. Thank you for continuing to nurture us so that we may grow into responsible citizens. We begin our service on page 185, or we can follow the screen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Hallelujah! Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah!
May His grace and peace be with you.
May He fill our hearts with joy.
Almighty God,
give you all our hearts open, all desires to know,
and from your evil
secrets that are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may be heard of your love, and where we can find our holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to His people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God,
yes.
Oh,
okay. Yes. bring money so that we can spend the money. Okay. Oh, just do that. Okay, yeah, but today we're not talking about them. Yes.
Sometime, okay? So that we can talk to us more. Bye. A reading from the book of Acts. Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription to an unknown God. What therefore you worship is unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole world, earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold, or silver, or stone, an image formed by the art and the imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed the day on which we will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm is Psalm 66. It's found on page 787 and 788, and we'll say it responsibly. Bless our God, you peoples. Make the voice of his praise to be heard.
Who holds our souls in life, and will not allow our feet to slip.
For you, O God, have proved us. You have tried us just as silver is tried.
You brought us to the snare. You laid embers upon our hearts.
You let enemies ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you brought us out into a place of refreshment.
I love to hear our souls with burnt offerings and obey my vows, which I promised to my lips and spoke with my mouth and my eyes to God.
I will offer you sacrifices of fat beasts with the smoke of rams. I will give you oxen and goats.
So that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Him, You know him because he abides in you, and he will be with you. I will not leave you orphans. I am coming to you in a little while. The world will no longer see me, and you will see me because I live, and you also live. On the day you will know that I am the Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by me. My Father and I love them and reveal myself to them. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated.
And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees you nor knows you. Lord Jesus Christ, you care for us so much that you couldn't leave us as orphans, but you are prepared to send the advocate, the Spirit of truth, the intercessor, so that he may stand for us. He may be there to also teach us the way. Help us that in all things that we do, we may refer to your Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit, who dwells in us, who dwells in you. We live in you, and you live in us. All this we ask through your name. Amen.
Amen.
So friends, here we are, sixth Sunday of Easter. And we are almost there. There again, as we bid farewell to our Lord Jesus Christ. So, the passage that we have read this morning, the Gospel passage from John, is one of those which is known as a farewell discourse, which are those words that Jesus said to his disciples as he was about to leave. And you know, the Christian cycle, after Easter, then comes the Ascension. After Jesus had spent 40 days with his disciples, he ascended to the Father. And so that's why we are now reading the farewell discourse. Last week we read about Jesus saying, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and then Philip saying, Lord, show us the Father. And Jesus said, I am in the Father. If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. And today again, we continue with that farewell discourse. And now here Jesus is saying, if you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. Now, when we read this, the question comes and say, if we are going to be given another advocate, which one is the first advocate? Right? Because he's saying, I will ask the Father so that he will give you another advocate, right? So, what is Jesus saying here? What is he saying to his disciples? Another advocate. We don't even know the first one. Am I now sounding like Philip as well? Lord, show us the Father, right? So here I'm also asking the question, who is the advocate? If you're going to give us another, who is the one right now, right? So the one is Jesus. Jesus is the advocate. While he is with his disciples, he is the advocate. Because he is the one who is going before the Father. I think you understand the legal system. The legal system has a lawyer who is called an advocate. An advocate pleads on your behalf. Sometimes I think, I always ask this question, why is it that you need a lawyer when you go to the courts of law? Is it that they want to take our money? Because I can just state the facts. Why do I need someone? Right? But I know that in such situations, you don't think straight. In such situations, you are too emotional. So you need someone who is an outsider to step in and speak on your behalf. You need someone who is there to control your emotions.
to tone them down and tell you, you know, this is the way we do things. Also, you need someone who knows the court system, who knows how to handle these things, right? So that's the work of a lawyer. But now when we talk about an advocate is a lawyer of lawyers. I don't know if that's the system that you understand, but I think from the British system that I understand, an advocate, his clients are lawyers. So you have your lawyer, you hire your lawyer to represent you, but that lawyer will go and hire another lawyer, right? And say, we are going to the courts, please represent me and my client. That's the work of an advocate. So the advocate goes before the judge, representing both the lawyer and the lawyer's client, who has come with a case. So when Christ is talking about an advocate in this instance, he is saying to us, I have been there for you. I have been standing before the Father for you guys. But now I am going. But in my place, I'm going to send someone else who will be standing with you. An advocate. One, the one who stands with you. The one who will tell you what to say when it comes to the crunchy matters. The one who also has integrity such that you will speak to the judge and the judge will listen to that person. Many times, the people who are advocates are people of integrity. If there is anything amiss in their lives, their license is withdrawn. Sometimes, when someone is found guilty, you will hear that the judge will say, we are releasing you into the custody of your lawyer or your advocate. So, this advocate is responsible for you and saying, he will not run away. I know him. I'm standing in for him. He will not run away. And the judge will respect that person. The judge will say, because of this person, okay, you can go. Now, Jesus is saying, I've been doing this job for you, but now I'm going, but I will not leave you as orphans. I'm going to send the advocate. So he is now talking about the Holy Spirit coming. And what is the work of the Holy Spirit? The advocate. The Holy Spirit is to be our advocate. The Holy Spirit is to stand for us. The Holy Spirit is to teach us. The Holy Spirit is to give us utterance whenever we are dumbfounded, whenever we cannot speak by our own. The Holy Spirit will tell us what to say. Have you ever wondered that as we read the Bible, each reader comes and they read, and when they are done, they will say, the word of the Lord. And the congregation will respond, thanks be to God. And I have wondered always, and I've said, they say that the word of the Lord, does it mean that it's God who was writing these words? Does it mean that God took a pen and paper and wrote all the words that we read in the Bible? And I even read another portion of scripture which says, all scripture is God-breathed. Others would want to say, all scripture is inspired by the Lord. And I've asked that question, is it God who wrote these words? Obviously, the answer is no. These were human beings who wrote these words. But they were God-breathed. But they were inspired by God. And how did this inspiration came to them? The advocate, the spirit of truth, the teacher, would come into these people so that they would write. And they were writing because they were being inspired by the Spirit of God, by this Holy Spirit, the Advocate. Now, have you ever wondered that there are some things that happen today, and we wonder, what is their place in the Bible?
Have you ever had people asking you, where is what you are doing this? Where is it written in the Bible? And sometimes you don't have an answer. You're confused. Or you call yourself a Christian, but what you are doing, is it somewhere in the Bible? Cell phone is not there in the Bible. The internet is not there in the Bible. Jesus never used some of these things. There was no train in Jesus' time. There was no car in Jesus' time. It's not there in the Bible. But how did we come to have these things? I believe it's the Spirit of truth. I believe it's the Holy Spirit of God. And some people will say, but science is demonic. No, I don't think that science is demonic. The Spirit of God comes to us. The Spirit of God inspires us. God breathes on us. And after His breath has come on us, we will do mighty things. We will do some things that are not even written in the Bible. And that's why sometimes I have problems with people who tell me that science is demonic. I don't think so. But science was given to us as a gift so that it may help us in how we live, so that it may teach us. It is only when we misuse science that it becomes demonic. So that's why I have a problem with people who will say, it's evil to do blood transfusion. But blood transfusion saves life. It's evil to harvest cells from another human being and give them to another human being. But that saves life as well, because this person has so much of these cells, right? And they're not being used. Why not give to the other person so that they may live? This person has so much blood. Why not harvest it and give to another person that they may live? That's why I have problems with people who talk against organ donation. They say, that's so evil. God has given us these organs and they are ours only to keep. My friend, if you are dying or if you are dead, what do you need a kidney for? Give it to the other person who is living. Because after all, it will rot in the ground. So why not just pass it on so that it lives in another person? And someone will ask me and say, where is it written in the Bible? It's never there in the Bible, so we will not do that. No, the Spirit of God teaches us some things that are not even written in the Bible. We don't need to go to the Bible to find answers for some of these things. We need to ask the question, does it keep God's commandment? And what is that commandment that Christ talks about? The commandment that Christ talks about, which is the major commandment in John chapter 13, love one another. If that thing is being done out of love, I don't think I need to go to the Bible and read and say, where is it found in the Bible? The Bible is not something that is given to us that we may go and find answers. But the Bible is a manual that was given to us so that it inspires us, it gives us the moral direction, and after that we go and behave as responsible beings. The Bible is there to inspire so that we may do mighty things for God. So there are other things that are not written in the Bible that people are doing out there, but they are all acts of love. They edify other people and they give glory to God. I've just given you some of those examples. Cell harvesting, organ donation, people talk about them and they will ask, where is it in the Bible? But here's the answer. The Spirit of God, the advocate, comes to us and he inspires us so that we may do mighty things out there, so that we may save lives. And that's why I like the Anglican Church. The Anglican Church talks about the three pillars. Scripture, tradition, and reason. The Anglican Church does not say we stick to Scripture, because not all answers are in Scripture. But there are the things that are found in our tradition. There are the things that are found through human reason. Now, through human reason, reason should be used responsibly. When we reason in love, we can do some of these things. We will say to ourselves, yeah, it's good to do organ donation because I'm spreading the love of God. I'm giving, I'm passing on to the next person. I may die today, but I can continue living in another person, knowing pretty well that my heart is being used by somebody else. I have lived my life. So someone can take this heart and live on. Someone can take this kidney and live on. Someone can take this skin and live on. Am I too deep? Am I scaring you? The advocate inspires us. The advocate will breathe on us and tell us that some of these things can be done. It's not anywhere in the Bible. It's not written. It never happened. But it's happening today. Why? Because the Spirit of God has inspired us. Science is a gift that we were given by God. And let us use it responsibly to the greater glory of God. The advocate will teach you everything. May the Spirit of God teach us those things that we don't understand. May the church not continue asking the question, where is it written in Scripture? But may we ask ourselves, where is the Spirit of love? May we ask ourselves, does this fulfill the commandments? Because here at the opening, Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. So that's the question that we need to ask first, before all the other things. Is it being done in the Spirit of love? Is it being done in keeping the commandments? If it is so, then let us do it. And that's why our church talks about those three pillars: Scripture, tradition, and reason. God bless us. And may He inspire us. May His Spirit breathe on us that we can do mighty acts to His greater glory. Amen.
The intercession, so congregation can say, may we know we abide in you, following the Lord, you abide in us. Lord, in you we live and move and have our being, for we are your children, and you are not far from any one of us. We pray for all who are being prepared for baptism or confirmation, and that we with them may know that we dwell in you and you in us. We pray for Christians who are struggling in lonely and difficult places, for all feel forsaken, for all who are longing to know for your love. We pray for all who seek to do your will and fulfill your commandments. Today in the local, national, international leadership, we pray for the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Most Reverend Justin Welby, the Primate of the Anglican Church of Canada, the Most Reverend Linda Nichols, the National Bishop of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Canada, Bishop Susan Johnson, the National Indigenous Archbishop, the Most Reverend Chris Harper, the Bishop of Rupert's Land, the Right Reverend Jeffrey Woodcroft, Bishop of the Manitoba Northwestern Ontario Synod, Bishop Jason Zinko, the Metropolitan of the Ecclesiastical Province of Rupert's Land, the Most Reverend Greg Kerr Wilson, and the Bishop of Central Uganda, the Right Reverend Michael Lavoie. And this Sunday, we pray in the Anglican Communion for the Church of the Province of West Africa. In the Anglican Church in Canada, we pray for the Right Reverend Michael Wilton, Bishop, and the clergy and people of the Diocese of Ontario. In the ELCIC, we pray for the assistant to the Bishop and the staff of the Saskatchewan Synod. In the Council of the North, we pray for the Diocese of Moosonee. And in Rupert's Land, we pray for our congregations and communities, especially the clergy and people of the Church of the Ascension Stonewall. And we pray for all mothers and grandmothers who suffered through the absence of their children away at residential schools. And in Central Uganda, we pray for the parish of St. Apollo, Kiba Bula Aya Dewau, the Reverend Robert Nogwa Raptor. And we also continue to pray for our companion parish of St. Peter's in Kijiji in the Diocese of Central Uganda and their priest, the Reverend Godfrey Matsiko. Lord, you abide in us. We pray for countries where laws are being flouted. We pray for nations and peoples who are in danger of destroying themselves and others. We remember areas of civil strife, areas where people are misused or abused. We pray for all who seek to live in simplicity, gentleness, and reverence, for all who suffer for doing good. Lord, you abide in us. By your indwelling presence, make our hearts and our homes places of peace. We pray for peace in our communities, for peace in our relationships, and your peace may spread throughout our world. In our parish cycle of prayer, we pray for Amanda Reed, Sean, Stacy, Travis, Dakota, and Lucas Reed, Gail Retty, and Heather and Shane Robinson. And we pray for all children and seniors in our community, especially those in Patricia Gardens and Princess Court. Lord, you abide in us. We pray for all who are captives to superstition or ignorance, for all who have no knowledge of God, for all whose lives are empty or filled with the wrong things. We remember before you all whose lives are falling apart, all who are entering into darkness or sickness, that each in their weakness may know your strength. In our parish, we pray for those who are sick and for those who have asked to pray for them. So today we remember Stan Brown, Marina and Bill Bowen, Penny Bruval, Haley Shute, Melanie C., Haley Gibbons, Dean Hodges, Susan Clemenson, Bill Landry, Lynn MacDonald, and Brian Reed. Lord, you abide in us. Lord, if we abide in you and you are in us, we are already in the fullness of that life which is eternal. We rejoice in your presence and pray for loved ones and friends who have gone before us. Lord, you abide in us. Lord Jesus, you have promised to be with us forever. Teach us to rejoice in your presence. Free us from all anxiety, Help us to know that you're always at hand, and that we may work with you and to your glory. Jesus Christ our Lord, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in the thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have not done. We have grown up unto God for God. We have grown up our neighbors as ourselves. We ask you for sorry and come in again. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please stand for the peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Peace, peace. Created us, when we turned away from you in sin, you not cease to care for us, but open the path of salvation for all people. You made a covenant with Israel, and through your servants, Abraham and Sarah, gave the promise of a blessing to all nations. Through Moses, you led your people from bondage into freedom. Through the prophets, you renewed your promise of salvation. Therefore, with them and with all your saints, we have served you in every age. We give thanks and raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy God, source of life and goodness, all creation rightly gives you praise. In the fullness of time, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He healed the sick and ate and drank with outcasts and sinners. He opened the eyes of the blind and proclaimed the good news of your kingdom to the poor and to those in need. In all things, he fulfilled your gracious will. On the night, he freely gave himself to death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Gracious God, this perfect sacrifice destroys the power of sin and death by raising him to life. You give us life forevermore. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ,
recalling his death, proclaiming his resurrection, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you, Father, this bread and this cup. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that all who eat and drink at this table may be one body and one holy people, and living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord, we died with you on the cross.
Now we are raised to new life.
We were buried in your tomb.
Now we share in your resurrection.
Live in us that we may live in you, the gifts of God, for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Blood of Christ, the cup of salvation.
Please come forward.
Thank you.
That's good. ask you one favor, please. When we come to church in the morning, let us keep silent in church, because others will be praying. So I'm just asking you, you know, sometimes when you watch the Facebook video, I can hear some people's stories. I can hear people talking, and you can even hear what they're saying. So I'm just urging you, please, when you come to church, let us be silent in church, give people time to reflect, give people time to pray. And also after communion, let us also have that time to reflect. Let us have that time to meditate. Let us not be talking. I'm asking you, please, so that we are in that atmosphere where we are reflecting on what God is doing for us, where we are reflecting on the message that we would have received as well.
No other announcements? Okay, closing hymn.
All things bright and beautiful.